knows a lot about the science stuff. Professor Dave explains.
As of late in this series, we have been covering all the animals in the clade Spiralia outside of the traditional Lophotrochozoa classification. Now it's time to delve into Lophotrochozoa, and we're beginning with the second most biodiverse animal phylum, the mollusks. All told, there are at least 85,000 extant species of mollusks. They are an incredibly diverse group of animals that include the snails, slugs, sea butterflies, clams, scallops, mussels, squids, oysters, octopuses, nautiluses, argonauts, and cuttlefish. Some, like the filter-feeding bivalves, are incredibly ecologically important organisms that, as adults, lack brains and are often sessile or non-moving. Others, like the octopuses, are widely accepted to be the most intelligent invertebrates on the planet and have complex methods of communication that science is just beginning to decipher. Mollusks range in size from the relatively simple, nearly microscopic, shell-less selenogasters to the several species of giant squid and the singular species of colossal squid, both of which can grow to sizes over 12 meters, or 39 feet, and weigh as much as 700 kilograms, or 1,500 pounds. Other mollusks, like the giant clams, can weigh up to 200 kilograms, or 440 pounds, but these massive creatures are in the minority. Over 80% of mollusks are less than 10 centimeters long as adults. Most mollusks are marine. Only the bivalves, like freshwater mussels, and the gastropods, like snails and slugs, have moved into freshwater environments. In fact, snails and slugs are the only terrestrial mollusks, and due to their need for relatively high humidity, their terrestrial range is a bit limited. However, like all species of mollusk, they still play crucial roles in the ecosystem. Not only are mollusks essential to the ecosystem, they're also essential to the world economy. In fact, mollusk aquaculture, where the animals, almost always bivalves, are raised under controlled conditions through part or all of their life cycle, kind of like aquatic farming, was a $441 million industry in the United States alone in 2018, and mollusks caught in the wild accounted for more than $1 billion in 2019, though the sustainability of this practice has been called into question. Suffice to say, mollusks are important, and most of us have probably interacted with them before. In addition to an occasional terrestrial gastropod, if you've ever gone shell collecting, you've seen a mollusk shell. Nearly all of the shells that wash up on the beach come from once-living mollusks. To be more specific, every seashell you've ever held is actually the corpse of a mollusk. You see, mollusks can't just leave their shells when they get too big. Unlike the arthropods, such as bugs and crustaceans, they can't shed their shells. They continue to grow with them their entire lives. Their shells are literally part of their bodies, secreted from the mantle. The only way they are separated from their shells is in death. However, not all mollusks have shells. In fact, the very name of their phylum, Mollusca, was originally derived from the Latin mollis, meaning soft, as a reference to their bodies, which are generally divided between the muscular head-foot portion used for locomotion, feeding, neurological control, and environmental sensing, and the protected visceral mass portion, which houses the majority of the other organs and organ systems. Protecting the visceral mass is the mantle, which is comprised of two folds of skin that are outgrowths of the dorsal wall. It is the outermost layer of the mantle that is responsible for secreting the characteristic mollusk shell. The head, foot, and visceral mass are easy to tell apart on a snail, but they are sometimes confused on other mollusks, like the cephalopods. For example, take a look at this picture of the common octopus, scientific name Octopus vulgaris. The large area behind the eyes, which is actually the visceral mass, kind of looks like it houses a huge brain. But that area actually houses the majority of the octopus's organs, somewhat like the human torso. The head is actually right here, and the mouth isn't up here, it's on the octopus's ventral end, down here. Let's now go over general mollusk anatomy and physiology in 8 sections. These will be as follows. 1. The head-foot region. 2. The radula. 3. Foot adaptations. 4. Visceral mass. 5. Shell composition. 6. Reproduction. 7. General characteristics. And 8. Molluscan cladistics. First, let's look a bit closer at the head-foot region. Like the common octopus, many but not all mollusks have well-developed head regions which contain their mouths and other specialized structures, like tentacles and photoreceptors. Some mollusks, like the scallops, have up to 200 eyes that dilate around their shells and contract. Others, like the chitons, have hundreds of tiny eyes less than 1 millimeter across, called ocelli, on each shell plate, complete with retina and lenses. Still others, like the snails and slugs, have vesicular or bubble eyes that sit atop their eye stalks. And then there's the pinhole eye of the nautilus, which contains a water-filled cavity, and the famously complex camera-type cephalopod eye that remarkably resembles a vertebrate eye. Though unlike the vertebrate eye, a cephalopod eye is focused through movement, much like the lens of a camera or telescope, rather than changing shape as the lens in the vertebrate eye does. Moving on, in addition to complex photoreceptors, there is a unique organ known as a radula that is a rasping, protractable, tongue-like organ found in all mollusks except the bivalves. Snails use it to scrape up food particles as they glide along a surface, and cephalopods use it to grind off pieces of their prey. In the cephalopods, the radula is located within the buccal bulb behind the sharp beak. Mollusk radula are covered in up to 250,000 teeth that rasp food and carry it like a conveyor belt in a continuous stream towards the digestive tract. Since the radula is often in use, it wears away anteriorly and is continually replaced by new secretions posteriorly. Each species of mollusk has a different pattern, morphology, and number of teeth on their radula. Some, like the venomous predatory cone snails, have modified radula that function as a hypodermic needle for capturing prey. In addition to highly modified radula, mollusks also show a wide range of foot adaptations that are usually adapted for locomotion or attachment. There are the attachment discs of the limpets, the laterally compressed hatchet foot of bivalves, and the siphon for jet propulsion in the cephalopods. In snails, the foot is controlled through body hydrology, that is, engorgement with blood. Moving on, let's take a closer look at the visceral mass. First, let's look at the mantle and mantle cavity, then the shell, and finally the internal structure and function. The mollusk mantle is a sheath of skin which extends from the visceral mass and hangs down each side of the body, protecting the animal's soft parts. This forms the mantle cavity that houses the respiratory organs, which aids in gas exchange and protects the digestive, excretory, and reproductive systems that all empty into the mantle cavity. The mollusk shell, when present, is made up of 3 layers. First, there is the periostracum, the organic outer layer. This is resistant to damage and provides most shell coloration. Then there is the prismatic middle layer, which is made of densely packed prisms of calcium carbonate. And finally, the continually excreted nacreous inner layer, made of mother-of-pearl in some mollusks. In terms of reproduction, most mollusks are dioecious, though some are hermaphroditic. Some species, like the cuttlefish and leopard slugs, have elaborate courtship rituals, while others, like many bivalves, simply release large quantities of sperm and egg into the water column. With these details covered, let's quickly summarize the most common characteristics of phylum Mollusca. 1. Mollusks have bodies separated into 2 parts, the head-foot and the visceral mass. 2. Mollusks have mantle cavities that function in excretion, gas exchange, and reproduction. 3. Mollusks are triploblastic, bilaterally symmetrical coelomates with reduced coelomes. Squid and octopuses are sometimes referred to as radially symmetrical, but they're not. They're bilateral. You can only separate them with one line of symmetry, just as with all mollusks. 4. Many mollusks have a free-swimming trochophore larva stage that emerges from their eggs. 5. Mollusks have an open circulatory system, except for the cephalopods. And 6. Mollusks have radula, except for the bivalves. Finally, let's briefly look at molluscan cladistics. Mollusks are generally split into 8 classes: the shell-less caudophoveatins and selenogasters, the 8 or 7-plated polyplacophorans, known as chitons, the single-shelled monoplacophorans, the land, sea, and freshwater-dwelling gastropods, the marine 2-shelled bivalves, the tusk shells of class Scaphopoda, and finally, the astoundingly intelligent and mobile cephalopods. Let's now move forward and start working our way through these classes so we can get a better sense of the incredible diversity in this phylum.
Thanks for watching. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.